Welcome to our ongoing series of the Book of Mormon Roundtable discussion. Today we're slated to discuss Ether, chapters 1 through 6. And my name is Keith Wilson, and I'm a professor of ancient scripture in the college in religious education at Brigham Young University. I have here today with me three of my colleagues, good friends, Andrew Skinner to my left, David Whitchurch to his left, and Stanley Johnson to his left. We're pleased to be able to discuss this and try to offer a few comments here as we further try to deepen our understanding of this great book. Today, the Book of Ether is a curious portion of the Book of Mormon, to say the least, because it's just like an insert into the Book of Mormon, almost a time warp, if you will. I've heard some say that this is the Book of Mormon in a microcosm, that you have 30 generations and 31 pages, the time frame. It's a whole different people, the record of the Jaredites. And so it's just kind of a fascinating thought to begin with. One thought that I love to raise is just, why did Moroni, who's the editor-in-chief of this portion of the Book of Mormon, why did he feel so compelled to select this record amongst all the records that he had there at his disposal to insert into the Book of Mormon? Certainly this was kind of a subjective choice on his part to put this extra record in, anachronistic and all those aspects. What are your thoughts on why the overall message and insertion of the Book of Ether just here in the tail end of the Book of Mormon?
Well, I really do think that it's the Book of Mormon in condensed form. You've got 1,500 years covered in the Book of Mormon. It touches on many of the themes that we've seen before in the Book of Mormon. Moroni says even though it's a long period of time and condensed so tightly, he hasn't told us a hundredth part of what he could have. But as we go through it, I think we do see many of the same themes and doctrines that we've seen throughout the entire Book of Mormon.
You know, this really becomes a second witness in so many ways. If you read earlier, as we're first introduced to Moroni, we know he's isolated. He's in a situation where he's by himself. He doesn't know how long he has to live. And you can see as seemingly as he concludes his record at the end of the Book of Mormon and bears his testimony of Christ, again, he doesn't know how long he has. And then placing this record at the end really does establish a second witness with regard to what happens to people who aren't willing to live by the covenants that they've been given. Mm-hmm. So it encapsulates a second story.
It's fascinating.
Culture.
It's almost like Moroni maybe had an aha moment when he read this text and it coincided so tightly with his testimony and his message that he then said, this has got to be a part, and put it in there. Now, what about the context of the Book of Ether? Kind of situate it for us, Stan. Where does it come in? Because it's sort of abrupt.
Well, it really... It starts at the Tower of Babel, and he said we could have gone clear back at the first, but we don't need to do that. You have that in the brass plates, and of course we have it in the Old Testament. So it starts there and talks about the compounding of the languages and how Jared and the brother of Jared, all that, they don't want theirs confounded, and so Jared goes to his brother. Evidently, Jared is the man in charge, but the brother of Jared has a connection there, it seems like, with the Lord. And so They don't want their languages confounded.
So the brother Jared, more like the administrative head or the leader, sort of the civic leader, the family leader, if you will, the brother of Jared, his brother, then being kind of the prophetic leader?
That's how I kind of look at it. Of course, we're guessing, but it looks like Jared's a king and Brother Jared's the prophet, you want to put it simply, in my mind.
Well, and as king, he and his descendants would have been the likely record keepers, and so it makes some sense that we have the language that
and
we
as
do
one here. Of you pointed out, which I hadn't realized before, is it really does come from the voice of Jared, and that was an interesting insight, you gave me.
Yeah. Also, It helps us to set a context for the rest of the Book of Mormon because it really describes the first scriptural group to arrive on the American continent, and that Jared or Moroni may have said, you know, there's an omission here, and this answers the questions that some people are going to have. Mm-hmm. So he includes it.
Well, as they contemplate departing from the Tower of Babel and finding a new place and being sent out and dispersed in that chapter one, he begins to pick up on a theme that certainly is prevalent at the first of chapter two, and that's the fact that they're going to a place that's been preserved for them. And especially this title that's carried throughout, the choice land. David, tell us some things about just how this setting lays the foundation for the choice land.
Well, I think for me, as I read through the Book of Ether, it's not just understanding the storyline of those that came over at the time of Jared and his brother, but it's really an opportunity for Moroni to give us little mini sermons or lessons in between. And so as you're reading along in chapter 2 and you're finding out that the Lord is going to send them to the promised land, then you get these short little pauses and Moroni begins to talk to us. For example, in verse 9 of chapter 2, now Jared and the brother of Jared are coming over here, those that are with them. And then in verse 9, and now we can behold the decrees of God concerning this land, that it is a land of promise, and whatsoever nation shall possess it shall serve God, or they shall be swept off when the fullness of His wrath shall come upon them, and the fullness of His wrath cometh upon them when they are ripened in iniquity. And then he goes on and begins to talk about, again, emphasizing the importance of the promises of regarding the land of promise. So again, Moroni in his commentary that he provides is extremely insightful, and he does it, he intersperses it throughout the entire Book of Ether.
Yeah, this book is just so deep that way, to see the layers that you're reading as you read any particular verse. I love the fact that this is also parallel. And if you want to do a parallel study of this whole notion of the promised land and the choice land that these peoples are brought to, 2 Nephi chapter 1 and Lehi's statements, very similar. But here for the Jaredites, it goes deeper, I believe. There's some things that are crystallized in a forceful way. So what are some of the doctrines here of the promised land quickly? And then let's move forward in the chapter.
One that hits me is that we'll be free from bondage. What a promise. I mean, if we serve the God of this land, I think about their whole history and how they were told, you know, you want a king? Well, good luck, because it will lead to bondage. And so it's definitely conditional.
And for me, if I can piggyback on that idea, there is a powerful paradigm for my life personally. And it is, and this goes back to chapter 1, verse 42, but it fits with what you're saying. The Lord says, there I will meet thee, and I will go before thee into a land which is choice above all other lands. And I suppose metaphorically or symbolically, we all go into different lands at different times. And some of them are choice lands and choice areas. Some of them maybe not so much, but the Lord's promise to us, if we're righteous, as it was to these people, I will go before you. I will be with you into this choice land of promise, and you will be free from bondage, because your freedom will be based in the only being in the universe that can guarantee your freedom, which is the Lord.
I love what you said. I will meet thee there. You know, yeah. I'll meet you there.
The Lord does meet us, doesn't
Isn't
he?
That neat?
He always meets us.
Yeah. What about the notion that this land, this promise or choice land, is a land that is designated as a land that worships the God of this land, who is Jesus Christ? We often, in our secular community all about us, have sort of this notion that religion cannot project into the public square, and that that we're supposed to keep it all private. And even if you're a Christian, that's supposed to be something that you kind of keep under your vest. Here the Book of Mormon teaches us that the land here is designated as a Christian land, and that it is to serve the Lord God Jesus Christ. And sometimes that falls on sort of some tensions amongst us. But that's the words of the Lord to the brother Jared here about the
Everybody
land.
Everybody wants to be politically correct, and I guess that's okay, except in this case, I mean, we can't forget that he is the God of this land, even Jesus Christ. And the promises are there.
Interestingly, about 90% of Americans profess a belief in Jesus Christ.
Right.
So few are really stating that. So
saying
you wonder,
and doing are two different things.
Yeah, and you wonder how much that kind of quiet belief, where that will lead us to.
Well, he says it actually there in verse 10. He says, "He that doth possess it shall serve God, or shall be swept off." And it is not until the fullness of iniquity. And we've had now, this will be the original, even though it's a different order, but this will be the first account of a people swept off this land. And then we've just finished the account of the Nephites, who were swept off. And now there is a pleading and a warning with regard to those who live here.
I was going to say, the law of witnesses really hit me when you said that. No, it really is the law of witnesses. Here we have two accounts of people being swept off.
Well, let's push forward. In the rest of the chapter 2, we have this great account of the challenges that they face with the barges and making this journey. And talk to us about what we learned from the challenges here and the really kind of quintessential model of revelation here that comes forth.
We got three basic challenges, very practical challenges. No light, how do we steer, and we can't breathe. So pretty yeah. critical. Yeah. Other than that, we're fine, yeah. You know. But what impresses me is the pattern for how the Lord not only deals with their specific concerns, but how then we can understand the Lord dealing with our concerns relative to the way he works in our lives. So in verse 20, for example, the Lord said unto the brother of Jared, behold, thou shalt make a hole in the top and the bottom. All right, so that the Lord, relative to one concern, the Lord tells them, you shall do this.
Just takes it right on.
Yeah, but look at verse 24. Behold, ye shall be as a whale, and so forth. What the Lord is saying there is, trust me, and I will do this for you. So first he says in verse 20, you do this, he just flat out tells them, and then in verse 24, trust me, I will do such and such. And then finally the third concern, which is discussed, I think, in verse 25, he says... 23. The Lord essentially says, you tell me how you think the problem should be solved. So it seems to me that the Lord is giving us kind of a paradigm for three ways in which our life's challenges are answered. Sometimes the Lord simply steps in and says, you do this. And sometimes the Lord steps in and says, trust me, and I will do this for you. And then at other times he said, okay, how do you think it should be done?
Well, that's good.
Yeah, it's almost like it's a great image of how the Lord leads us and still balances our agency.
Elder Scott gave a talk in conference years ago, and then he just said it again recently, I think, for emphasis. I used to have people come to me when I was serving as bishop and say, I've been praying about this, bishop. I don't get it. I don't get any response. It doesn't seem to come. What do I need to do? And I used to say, well, pray harder. You know, I wasn't sure what to say. And then Elder Scott gave this talk, which is what you're saying. He said, sometimes the Lord answers yes to give us confidence. Sometimes he answers no to prevent error. Sometimes he withholds the answer. And in those situations, we're not to sit around and do nothing. We're to act on correct principles and things that we've understood in the past. And then he says he won't leave us alone. They'll send us little packets of help to let us know if we're on course or if we're not. Well, it seems to me that's what I'm hearing here.
Exactly.
Sometimes he withholds the answer.
That's the pattern.
We figured out.
If we could get this one principle down, it would bless our lives so deeply,
yeah,
wouldn't it?
It would.
Well, let's talk about what he decides to do.
Could I just make one other point, too? It seems to me in chapter 2, we're talking about vessels that carry people. But what's really interesting, if we think about it, is that we're all vessels. People are vessels. And we have many accounts in scriptures where individuals are talked about as being chosen vessels. So I think maybe the Lord and Jared and even Moroni saw that this could be a real teaching tool if we'll read past the period at the end of the sentence.
In fact, some have said this whole account is like the plan of salvation,
yeah,
and you can follow it right through until they come to the promised land. Well, let's talk about the solution he comes up with. David, what does he come up with?
Well, he's going to go to work, and he's going to create some stones and then plea before the Lord to touch those stones, in order that they might have light. And ultimately, that's the solution that he's seeking.
Interesting solution.
Yeah, we need light, and the source of that light, by the way, is from God, which is, again, a pattern of life, isn't it? That we receive light from God.
It says in verse 1 that these small stones were white and clear, even as transparent as glass. And I remember talking to one of our colleagues who showed me an article in the National Geographic magazine, which talks about glass dating back to not only the area from whence the Jaredites came, but also roughly the same time period, which I thought was a nice correspondence, a nice, not necessarily proof, but kind of a help. To help us know that, yeah, there are some verifications of what's being said in Scripture.
Isn't it interesting the way, as the brother Jared takes these stones back then, and as he prays to the Lord, it's almost like the Spirit is channeling his thoughts. He bears testimony, if you will, there in verse 4. I know, O Lord, that thou hast all power and that you can touch these stones. It's almost like the Spirit's guiding him into this solution. It's a great image, isn't it, of the way he does that? Now, tell us some more about what happens. The Lord's finger comes and touches him. David?
Well, verse 6, I think, is, let me just read it. I think it says it best. And it came to pass that when the brother of Jared had said these words, behold, the Lord stretched forth his hand and touched the stones one by one with his finger, and the veil was taken from off the eyes of the brother of Jared, and he saw the finger of the Lord, and it was as the finger of a man likened to flesh and blood. And the brother of Jared fell down before the Lord, for he was struck with fear. I mean, this is a moment in the life of the brother of Jared, of course, in history, which I don't think we have quite a parallel for. That here, as he's seeking one thing, he has a very different experience in seeing the hand of the Lord, the finger of the Lord, as if it were flesh and blood. And this predates the coming forth of the Savior by
a couple thousand years.
Yes.
Well, now in a most interesting encounter, just fascinating, we follow through the account after he sees this finger, and the Lord asks some questions. Sometimes I even refer to them as obtuse questions. Okay, what's behind all of that? We often think of questions as things that where we need information. The Lord obviously doesn't need information here. What's going on in this account?
And maybe he's trying to get the brother of Jared to realize what kind of faith the brother of Jared really possesses. He's asking probing questions that will allow this great prophet to have some aha moments to realize exactly where he stands relative to his own faith.
Plus, it becomes a revelation as he learns about the nature of Christ and what he's going to be doing, that he'll become Emmanuel, that he will dwell upon the earth, that he will take upon himself flesh and blood.
To me, it also fits in with that notion of King Benjamin where he says the enticings. There it's the enticings of the Holy Spirit. Here it's the enticings of the Lord himself.
He's kind, drawing them out a little bit.
Isn't this a great image of man leaving heaven and then being drawn back to God and to his Maker? Sawest thou more than this? You know, it's almost like, did it stop? Now, Brother Jared, could you really think about maybe if there's something connected to a finger? You know, he's just
it's almost like the Lord is saying, Brother Jared, get over your surprise, you know, get over the initial shock, and let's probe deeply to see what lies in the depths of your soul. And out of that then comes this magnificent manifestation.
And sometimes we marvel to the point where we miss the point.
Yeah.
And honestly, this would be a time to marvel, but get over it now, let's talk.
One of Moroni's themes will be very repetitive, come unto Christ. And this is almost like he saw the process happening in this person's life, this prophet's life, and just wanted to hold it up. Now, what about what is revealed there? Let's talk some about down in verses 14 and 15.
We ought to read those verses. They're
please.
Powerful verses. Verse 14 of chapter 3, behold, I am he who is prepared from the foundation of the world to redeem my people. Behold, I am Jesus Christ. I am the Father and the Son. In me shall all mankind have life, and that eternally, even they who shall believe on my name, and they shall become my sons and my daughters. And never have I showed myself unto man whom I have created, for never has man believed in me as thou hast. Seest thou that ye are created after mine own image? Yea, even all men were created in the beginning after mine own image.
Boy, those verses are loaded with deep doctrine,
aren't they, about the Lord?
You know, preceding verse 14, it says specifically, because thou knowest these things, ye are redeemed from the fall.
Yeah.
To be redeemed from the fall is to come back into the presence of God.
And look what that means in the context of what the brother of Jared has said. Way back in verse 2, the brother of Jared has said something about the fall. And in fact, this is one of the most powerful verses in all of Scripture about the nature of the fall. About a third or two-thirds of the way down in verse 2, because of the fall, our natures have become evil continually. Now, that's a stunning statement in Latter-day Saint Scripture. And I don't think it means that, you know, that we're not born with the spark of divinity. And I simply think it means that when we're born into this world, the fall surrounds us, infuses us, touches almost everything that we do, that we need some help. It's like the principle of entropy. If you leave human beings alone, if you leave planets alone or universes alone, they're going to wind down because of the fall. What Jesus Christ does, he says, you're redeemed from the fall, you're going to be infused with energy that which will bring eternal life.
Nevertheless really answers the question. And, you know, whenever the fall is presented, the flesh, we're all going to have problems with the flesh. Nevertheless, O Lord, thou hast given us. And then we talk about the Lord's help and his atonement and his mercy and his grace.
You know, I heard a chemistry professor one time here on campus say it this way. He said, the only thing I've ever found that reverses the entropy of human life is the gospel of Jesus Christ, and more particularly the atonement of Jesus Christ.
I think that's what we learn here, among many other things that you pointed out.
Well, we've got to hustle. Should we make a comment about never have I shown myself unto man? That's a doctrinal point that often is discussed and kicked around. There's a wide variety of possibilities for this verse, and I don't think we really need to hang our hat on any one, but what are a couple possibilities about Jesus Christ showing himself here in spirit form to someone?
Possibility is it is having to do with this dispensation. That is a possibility, that never in this dispensation have I shown myself in this manner.
So another possibility is that he's saying, never before have I shown myself and identified myself specifically as Jesus Christ. Before, I have talked to prophets, beginning with Father Adam, as though I were the Father, in my role as Jehovah, speaking as though I were God the Father, by divine investiture of authority. Now, he's saying, for the first time, I've identified specifically that I am Jesus Christ.
Or that he's never showed himself unto man with that manifestation of flesh and blood that is going to come.
Uh-huh. Or that he's never shown himself unto fallen man and redeemed in that process. So there's a variety of things here. This is such a great record. We've just barely begun to scratch the surface of it. Why don't we step back now? We've talked about these high points, the choice land, the process of revelation, the process of even coming to Christ, and this model of the Lord wanting to draw us back to Him. Andy, why don't you take it for this last minute and just summarize for us this first portion of the Book of Ether?
Well, I think that you hit the nail on the head when you said that this book is ultimately written to bring us to Christ. I would urge us to take a look quickly at Ether chapter 4, verses 11 and following. This seems to me to be the message not only of Ether, but the whole Book of Mormon. Verse 11, "But he that believeth these things which I have spoken, him will I visit with the manifestations of my Spirit. And he shall know and bear record, for because of my Spirit he shall know that these things are true, for it persuadeth men to do good. And whatsoever thing persuadeth men to do good is of me, for good cometh of none save it be of me. I am the same that leadeth men to all good. He that will not believe my words will not believe me, that I am, and he that will not believe me will not believe the Father who sent me. For behold, I am the Father, I am the light, I am the life, I am the truth of the world." And then in verse 13 and 14, "Come unto me, O ye Gentiles, come unto me, O ye house of Israel." That's the message of Ether.
Well, and it certainly rings true, I'm sure, to all of us here when it says, "For because of my Spirit, ye," or he, "shall know that these things are true." What a great thing this Book of Mormon is.